morning when I was brushing my teeth that I'd be doing this, and so I was just kind of trying to listen, you know. The Lord is always talking to us. That's what we've kind of been talking about the last few weeks. He's all around us. We just have to listen. And sometimes it's the still small voice, and sometimes it's the songs on the radio. Sometimes it's the Amazon playlist. It's all sorts of different things. And this past week, every time I turn on a song, it's, how deep does this river run? How deep is your love? How deep, and I was thinking of the children's song this morning. Deep and wide, deep and wide, there's a river. Remember doing that Sunday school? There's a fountain flowing. And as a child, we used to sing those songs, but it's so funny how when you're an adult, you think back and you're like, wow, those are powerful messages in the simplest, you know, how deep, and you get as big as you can deep, and how wide, and how, you know, and it's so true. We can't, our arms aren't big enough, right, to understand the depth and the breadth. And so this morning I'm going to read from Ephesians chapter 3. This is Paul who says, you know, even I'm surprised by how God's plan is so much more than what even I thought it was. And I thought I was an expert. I thought I was doing good things. And then God opened my eyes, and he's still surprising me about how he loves everybody, how the breadth and the depth of his love is just always surprising. And so here I am preaching and writing about things that are way over my head, the inexhaustible riches and generosity of Christ. My task is to bring out in the open and make plain what God, who created all this in the first place, has been doing in secret and behind the scenes all along. How many of you know God's working? Whether we see it or not, God is working. And it's our job to bring it out in the open.
Yes.
It's our job to bring it out in the open, where it can be heard, where it can be seen, where it can be felt. Whether it's embrace, a smile, an encouraging word.
Yes.
Through followers of Jesus Christ, like yourselves, gathered in churches, this extraordinary plan of God is becoming known and talked about even among the angels. The angels wonder, what is it about those human beings that he created, that he's allowing them to reveal his glory in the earth? All this is proceeding along lines planned all along by God and then executed in Jesus Christ. When we trust in him, we are free to say whatever needs to be said, bold to go wherever we need to go. So don't let my present trouble on your behalf get you down. Mm-hmm. Be proud. My response, his response to his persecution, to his troubles, my response is to get down on my knees before the Father, this magnificent Father who parcels out all heaven and earth. He's given it to us as a gift and said, watch over my gift. My creation is a gift to all of us.
Yes.
It was given to us for our pleasure.
Uh-huh.
I ask him to strengthen you by his spirit, not brute strength, but a glorious inner strength. Oh, that glorious inner strength that comes and it brings peace. That glorious inner strength that comes and it lifts us up when we feel broken down. That Christ will live in you as you open the door and invite him in. How simple. How simple. Every time we stop, and we just stop and we just say, Lord, and we just open our hearts, we open our ears, we open our minds, and he is there and he walks in. And he brings that glorious inner strength with him. And I ask him that with both feet planted firmly on love, you'll be able to take in with all followers of Jesus the extravagant dimensions of Christ's love. Reach out and experience the breadth. Test its links. Plumb the depths. Rise to the heights. Live full lives, full in the fullness of God.
Amen.
I don't know about anybody, but I want to live a full life.
Yes.
Not blown here and there, not running the rat race, not worried about, you know, I mean, work can be all consuming.
Exactly.
The pressures of family, the responsibilities of family, just dealing with the stuff that goes with being a human being in this world. But are we living full lives?
Right.
Wednesday night, Jesus fills. Jesus fills. The more empty we are of self, the more our desperate need, the more places we have emptied and ask him to come fill in our lives, he experience that inner divine glory.
Amen.
He does it not by pushing us around, but by working with us, his spirit deeply and gently within us.
Mm-hmm.
He's gentle. Oh, I don't know, but he wants that intimacy. And I feel like he wants just us in those quiet moments to take time from our busy lives,
mm-hmm.
and just put him first.
Amen.
And just lay it all out. You know, and it's so funny, you know, last year it was actually a pretty good year. I didn't have a lot of, you know, issues. I didn't, you know, and I was thinking, wow, you know, I listened to the prayer requests and I just was thankful that I didn't have, you know, massive prayer requests, massive needs. But those are the times when it's sometimes the hardest to just remember,
mm-hmm.
that just waking up and taking a breath,
yes.
and putting our feet on the ground is a
yes.
blessing. We are given
yes.
this day and
yes.
we are given a purpose and a plan, you know, and our church, you know, people come and go, and sometimes it's full and sometimes it's not. And we're so important, every single one of us.
Amen.
Yes.
Every single one of us are essential to what God wants to do in this
Amen.
Body and in this house.
Amen.
What God has given us in this place is precious.
Yes.
It is precious and it is rare. And it needs to be shared. And maybe
yes.
it's not to bring people into this house, but it needs to be shared. It is bigger than these four walls.
Amen.
It is.
And I just encourage you to live lives full, because the more we pour out,
mm-hmm.
the more God pours in.
Exactly.
And there is such a blessing that comes in the pouring out of ourselves.
Exactly.
That when God fills it back, I mean, there is no lack.
Exactly.
That fountain is deep and wide, and that fountain is eternal. There is no end.
Exactly.
There, it's not a river that's going to run dry.
No.
It is a river. And you know what's funny? I was, there's a today... The Today Show is having these commercials on the whatever, on demand, on media, on the prime time. And it just caught my ear when the guy was where flooding had been. He says, oh, water is the most destructive force. And I thought, you know, maybe in the natural, water can be destructive, but there is a holy water that when we drink it, it is not destructive. It is life-giving.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's just funny. And we talk a lot about the river, and we talk a lot about, you know, letting it flow. Let it be deep and wide in our lives,
Amen.
Each one of us, and just watch what God will do.
Yeah.
In Jesus'
Amen.
Name.
Praise God. Yeah.
Anybody have any prayer requests or testimonies this morning? Yeah, James.
I'm here for Brother Joe. I've been talking to Mike a lot of times, and he landed a job at Fat Tuesday. It's not, you know, a lot of hours, but he's a good worker. He's going to teach me to cook. He's teaching me some more manual skills that I need to know growing up. He's been a good brother, and it's just,
no matter what happens today, I know He made this day, and I'll just rejoice and be glad in it.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God.
Lord.
So last Wednesday, I asked a prayer for one of Kelly's friends, Nicole. She had an OBGYN appointment for 12 weeks. And good news, they found a heartbeat.
Yes.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Very excited. That's good.
Amen.
And then I'm very thankful for the opportunities that God gave me to do things. The new session for the gym that I am, for the new people to be in the program, started last Monday. And I was asked to be a coach, which is very humbling and a really nice opportunity. So I pray that God gives me the wisdom to guide these people through the program as I went through it, and also gives them the motivation to continue on after this is over. And also, yesterday I was playing Bob the Builder at Kelly's house. I put together a compost bin. So
you can do it.
Yeah.
Yes, he can.
We're working our way to becoming urban farmers, because we're going to raise chickens in the backyard and all that.
Don't tell my husband that.
Yeah. So I'm very thankful that all these things are happening, that He has given me the wisdom to change and become the person that I am right now, that I can actually do those things and enjoy them.
Mm-hmm.
She's very excited about the chickens. I'm just going along with that. I'm just thankful that I have her in my life. And there's not a dull moment.
Praise the Lord.
Lord. Any prayer requests?
If you need help, Izzy's the chicken whisperer.
Okay.
She is.
Good to know. Everybody needs a chicken whisperer in their life.
Yeah.
church of hearts. Jesus, let us pour out all of the gifts that you have blessed us with. Let us pour it out to be like this, Lord, an offering, Lord, an offering for your glory, for your kingdom. To glorify you, to lift up your name, Jesus.
You are worthy, Lord Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you that you bless us and you keep us,
Lord.
Thank you that this is the day that you have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it.
Glory to your name,
we give you thanks, Lord. Heavens and the earth that you created, Lord, and you gave us dominion over it, Lord.
Glorify, magnify your holy name.
Thank you, Lord, that all of creation cries out, Lord, for the manifestation of the sons and daughters of God. Those who will rise up and be bold and speak forth your kingdom, Lord, that your kingdom will come. Where we become one together, Lord. Abba, Father, we love you. Abba, Father, good and great, merciful Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Keep hearing you're a good, good Father. A reminder that if you have a cell phone with you, to please turn it off. All right, Mike Fox. That needs to go to the top of the God box. Okay. I don't know that I have that.
Okay. Next Saturday, or next Friday night from 9 till 9, Saturday night, it will be a 24-hour prayer burn up at Kingdom House of Prayer. It's at the north end of the Heartland Church Complex in Ankeny. We're slated in again on Saturday from 5 to 7. So, if you can be there at any of those times, any of that time just to pray, it's a time for the body of Christ to come together and intercede for this region. We'll go up and press in. The spirit of revival is gripping people's hearts. They had the Azusa Now thing out in California, and it was a good, awesome gathering that I saw. But I know the Lord wants to do something specific here. Even Lou Engel's comment about when he was here, about Iowa being the field of dreams. Also, one of the deep translations of the name Iowa is Sleepy One. And I believe the awakening in Iowa is now occurring. We want to be on the front edge of this thing. Even though a couple of us can't make it to that, the team will be there in its capacity to do what the Lord has called us to do. So pray for us. Pray for the prayer burn. If you can come up and join. in with us. There'll be a lot of time of prayer, and since it will be a prayer burn, there'll be worship, but it's going to be all vertical worship to him. It's all about him. There'll be songs of revival of what God done in the past, but it's also a marker of from then that we're moving forward to what God wants to do now.
Yes,
God wants to do a new thing, and we need to focus on watching him instead of what he did, what he wants to do now. So it'll be a transitional time, I believe, and just need y'all to let us, at least in prayers, to work through this.
Amen.
All right, let's speak the word this morning. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? Now I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick, and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness or disease to come upon this body. Every disease, germ, and every virus that touches this body dies instantly in the name of Jesus. Every organ and every tissue of this body functions to the perfection to which God created it to function. And I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened. I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Hallelujah.
Lord. John, you want to come take the offering this morning, please? Thank you.
Lord, we thank you today for another beautiful day that you've given us, God, with your presence. Makes everything beautiful, and we just lift you up and are thankful and pray for this offering, God, for your blessing upon it and the people as we give you.
Yes.
As you multiply it, God, and have your way in this place today. We just want to have our freedom in you.
Yes,
you are freedom and you are love, and thank you, God, for your kindness and great love in your holy name, Jesus. Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ready, James? Hallelujah. Glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is truly the day that the Lord has made. And we will rejoice. Be glad in it.
Hallelujah.
Got her, James? Hallelujah. So we got three more services, maybe four more services to shake the rest of those loose shingles before we put the steeple back up there. So as soon as Jane clicks in there, we'll get rolling. Lift your voices up and praise the King.
Amen, man. Praise God.
For your glory. For your glory.
Jesus, Jesus. Every knee will bow, every tongue confess, Jesus Christ, He is Lord forever.
Yes.
We don't have the overhead. You guys know the song.
Things are changing.
Every knee will bow, every tongue confess. Jesus Christ, He is Lord forever.
Jesus Christ is Lord forever. Every knee will bow, every tongue confess. Jesus Christ is Lord forever. Can't stop, praise His name. Can't stop, praise His name. Just can't stop, praise His name, Jesus. Can't stop, praise His name. Every tongue confess, Jesus Christ is Lord forever. Every knee will bow, every tongue confess, Jesus Christ is Lord forever. Can't stop, praise His name. Can't stop, praise His name. Just can't stop, praise His name, Jesus. Can't stop, praise His name. Can't stop, praise His name. Just can't stop, praise His name, Jesus.
He's the Prince.
He's the Prince of Peace.
Bright and morning star.
Bright and morning star.
Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ is Lord forever.
He's the Prince of Peace.
He's the Prince of Peace, bright and morning star. Jesus Christ is Lord forever. Can't stop, praise His name. Can't stop, praise His name. Just can't stop, praise His name, Jesus. Can't stop, praise His name. Can't stop, praise His name. Praise His name, can't stop. Praise His name, I just can't stop. Praise His name, Jesus. Can't stop. Praise His name, can't stop. Praise His name, just can't stop. Praise His name, Jesus. Can't stop. Praise His name, can't stop. Praise His name, just can't stop. Praise His name, Jesus. Can't stop, praise His name. Just can't stop, praise His name. Just can't stop, praise His name, Jesus. He's the Prince of Peace, bright and morning star. Jesus Christ is Lord forever. He's the Prince of Peace, bright and morning star. Jesus Christ is Lord forever. Can't stop, praise His name. Can't stop, praise His name. I just can't stop, praise His name, Jesus. Can't stop, praise His name. Can't stop, praise His name. Just can't stop, praise His name.
Hallelujah, Lord. I love you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
I love you, Lord.
Oh,
I love you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, speaking out, Lord, in all your creation, Lord. Truly, this is the day that you have made. Streets will be filled with oil of your presence, Lord. These streets will be filled with the oil of your presence because your people have chosen to go out, Lord, and pour out on this dying land. Your people have chosen, Lord, to rise up and release the kingdom that is within us, Lord. I believe it, Lord. I believe it. Sing it, church. I believe.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. For it's even by your faith that we believe.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You've done it all, Lord. It is finished in Jesus' name. Lord, we thank you, Lord, that because of your grace, we stand here today as believers. Thank you, Lord. No better than anyone, but accepted by a holy God, because of his great work, we're able to stand here today and say, I believe. I believe, and everything in this world testifies to your reality, to your truth. Thank you, Lord, for showing us yourself in all of creation. We bless you this morning, Lord. For you are a good and a mighty God. There's none like you, Lord. You alone are God. And we worship you this morning. And thank you for the revelation of you. Everybody said, in Jesus' name, amen. Give the Lord a big hand clap. Praise God. Thank the Lord. Amen. God bless you. Be seated. Sunday school kids, if you haven't already, you may go downstairs. Thank you, Mike and worship team. Tremendous. Thank you, Suzanne, for opening and sharing with us this morning. Praise God. God is good. Amen?
Amen.
Thank the Lord. Amen. Praise God. I was a little surprised that so many people were missing this morning. Well, I don't know if surprise is the right word, but I was thinking as nice as the weather is and everything, you know. But sometimes, maybe there's something going on that I didn't know about. Praise the Lord, or maybe I'd have been there too. Hallelujah. Reminded me of a story about a woman who, her and her husband got up in the morning, he was getting ready to go to work, and she said, honey, do you know what today is? And he said, well, of course I know what today is. Do I look like I'm, you know, totally out of tune with reality? And he said, yes, I know what today is. And so he left and went off to work, and about 2 hours later, a delivery man came with a dozen roses for her. She was all excited and got the roses, and wasn't too long, maybe a couple hours later, another delivery guy shows up with a big, huge box of candy. And so she was really, you know, really getting crazy. This is insane, you know, and she gets the candy, and another few hours later, here comes a designer dress delivered directly to the door. Now, she can't wait for her husband to get home, you know. He comes home after work, and she said, honey, I can't tell you how excited I was today. This is the best Arbor Day I've ever had in my life. Praise the Lord. So sometimes we know what's going on and sometimes we don't. Praise the Lord. But we do know that God's on the throne. Amen. And he has his purposes, and praise God. We get to be part of it. Amen. So let's get right into the Word of God this morning. We want to start with Romans chapter 8, and we're going to read verses 1 through 7. Romans 8, and then we're going to read verses 1 through 7. Praise God. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death. To be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it's not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So, praise the Lord. Let's go to 1 Kings. 1 Kings chapter 17 and read verses 1 through 7 again there. 1 Kings 17, verses 1 through 7. Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, As the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years, but according to my word. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, Get thee hence, and turn thee eastward, and hide thyself by the brook Cherith, that is before Jordan. And it shall be that thou shalt drink of the brook, and I have commanded the ravens to feed thee there. So he went and did according unto the word of the Lord, for he went and dwelt by the brook Cherith, that is before Jordan. And the ravens brought him bread and flesh in the morning, and bread and flesh in the evening, and he drank of the brook. And it came to pass after a while that the brook dried up, because there had been no rain in the land. So, praise God. The story of Elijah and his success and his failure is really the story of us. It's the story of all of us. Anybody struggling with frustration of being spirit in a human body can get revelation from Elijah's journey. That's us. Spirit beings, but confined to a physical body, or at least in a physical body. It's frustrating. Anybody ever get frustrated knowing you're one thing but doing something else? You know, having a revelation of who you are in Christ and yet feeling manipulated by your own limitations, by your own humanity. This drought that we're talking about here lasted more than 3 years, and a famine intensified. And with this intensification of the famine came an intensification of Ahab's hatred for Elijah, because they blamed him for everything that was going on. Of course, Elijah said, there's not going to be any rain till I say so. So everybody's suffering, and Ahab is angry because it's Elijah and he can't do anything about it. So let's go to 1 Kings now, chapter 18, and we'll read verses 36 to 41. I'm going to stay close to these scriptures here today just to keep everything in context, or try to at least, so that we can see what I believe God is really trying to show us. These are not just historic events, although they are historic. It's God trying to show us something about us. He's trying to teach us something. He's trying to give us revelation. All of this word is revelation. It's just a question of whether or not we receive it that way. So it came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice that Elijah the prophet came near and said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known this day that thou art God in Israel, and that I am thy servant, and that I have done all these things at thy word. Hear me, O Lord, hear me, that this people may know that thou art the Lord God, and thou hast turned their heart back again. Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice and the wood and the stones and the dust, and licked up the water that was in the trench. And when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces, and they said, The Lord, he is the God. The Lord, he is the God. And Elijah said unto them, Take the prophets of Baal, let not one of them escape. And they took them, and Elijah brought them down to the brook Kishon and slew them there. And Elijah said unto Ahab, Get thee up, eat and drink, for there is a sound of abundance of rain. If you will, Roberto, drop down to, and we'll read verses 45 and 46 of this same chapter. Now, you know the story. Elijah, the people of Israel were, it wasn't like they quit believing in God. They just started believing in other gods as well as God. That God had been just kind of diminished to being just a God. Not the God, but just another God. And so God, Elijah, had built this altar, and with the altar he dug a trench around it, and then he not only did he put the wood on it for the fire, but then he poured buckets of water on top of this until it actually was so much water that it filled the trench all the way around it, so that there would be no question that if fire fell, it would be from God. And then he challenged these prophets of Baal, this false god, these prophets to call on their god, and he'd call on his god, and we'd see who is God, who sends the fire, who will bring the sacrifice and burn it up. And, of course, they cut themselves. They did all sorts of, you know, exercises in futility, and nothing happened. And Elijah gets up, and he said, God, your God, prove it. And bang, the fire hits, and not only does it consume the sacrifice, but it consumes the altar itself and dries up all the water that's around it. The result is the people all say, well, obviously, he's God. And he said, then kill these people that are preaching a false god, that are trying to take you away from God. And so they did. They killed the 450 prophets of Baal. And it came to pass in the meanwhile, and then, of course, Elijah tells Ahab, he's thinking, now you got to put this in context. Now we think, well, you know, he just did this and then he freaks out. No, he did it, and then he assumes, because of this great miracle, that Ahab's going to repent. That Jezebel, his wife, are going to say, like everybody else, that's God, all right. We can't argue with it, right? So he tells Ahab, get going, head for home, because there's going to come a great abundance of rain. I'm calling the rain. I'm calling on God to bring the rain back and bring water to the land again. So Ahab takes off. And it came to pass in the meanwhile that the heaven was black with clouds and wind, and there was a great rain. And Ahab rode and went to Jezreel. And the hand of the Lord was on Elijah, and he girded up his loins and ran before Ahab to the entrance of Jezreel. So another miracle. Ahab's in a chariot. He takes off. Elijah's on foot, and he passes the chariot, and the chariot following him. How many of you know most people can't run as fast as a horse? Praise the Lord. Amen. So God is showing that Elijah's his guy. Elijah's the guy that he's using in this situation. Amen. So Elijah then, because of all this, is expecting repentance. He's expecting Ahab and Jezebel to go, whoa, who can fight against this? This is God, right? So let's go to 1 Kings now, chapter 19, and verses 1 and 2. Anybody have a tremendous move of God in your life, and then it seems like everything goes south? You know, it's like it's all working perfectly as everything's in flow, and then all of a sudden, bang, it's like you hit a valley. You're in a place where you just weren't expecting it because things are going so good. God is so powerful. God is so real. Amen? So Ahab told Jezebel that what Elijah had done and how he had slain all the prophets with the sword, and then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah saying, oh, forgive us for being so stupid. Your God is God. No. No, she sent a messenger to Elijah saying, so let the gods do to me and more also if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow this time. In other words, kill me or I'm killing you before morning. You're done. I'm going to put all my resources as the queen and with the king's abilities and resources, and we're going to kill you. We're going to run you down and we're going to destroy you. Now, I got to tell you, Elijah had to have been shocked. It was not what he was expecting. He was expecting revival. He was expecting something tremendous. You know, all this chaos that's been going on here and all this unbelief is going to turn to faith. It's going to turn to people turning to God and believing God. And in fact, it turns into a death sentence for himself. So the spiritual hero that we just witnessed begins to melt. Praise the Lord. Elijah turned and ran for his life. Amen? The spiritual giant is just a man. He went from walking in the spirit to being in the flesh that quick. Instead of faith, fear is in control. You know, part of the problem is that Elijah was never meant to be a miracle worker. Now that may sound confusing, but the truth is, Elijah was meant to just believe God. And God would take care of the miracles. You know, even in under the new covenant, Jesus tells us that. I don't think sometimes we get it because we're looking for miracle people that do miracles. So the truth is, this is what he actually said. These signs will follow them that believe. He didn't say, I'm making you a miracle worker. He just said, miracles will happen if you believe. God will still be the one doing the miracles. Don't confuse yourself with God. Amen. The miracles will happen, but they happen because we believe that God's a miracle worker.
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Elijah, somehow this slipped. Because now he's thinking it's all about me, and I'm in big trouble, and I'm out of here. Before this Jezebel, amen, catches up with me, right? So let's go to 1 Kings 19, verses 3 through 8 now. When he saw that, he arose and went for his life and came to Beersheba, which belongeth to Judah, and he left his servant there. And I might just throw this in as a side. This is what the devil always does, try to get you by yourself. The time that he needed somebody who was a believer with him more than any other time was right here, and instead he dumps him. I don't know if he thought he was going to slow him down or if he thought he was going to protect him somehow. But that's what we do. We isolate ourselves. We separate ourselves whenever we get into fear, whenever we get into anxiety, whenever we think that something bad is happening, that God isn't going to do what we thought he was going to do or he isn't doing what we expected him to do. We get just solo. Praise the Lord. So he leaves his servant, and he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a juniper tree, and he requested for himself that he might die and said, it's enough now, O Lord, take away my life, for I'm not better than my father. And as he lay and slept under a juniper tree, behold, then an angel touched him and said unto him, arise and eat. And he looked, and behold, there was a cake baking on the coals and a cruse of water at his head, and he did eat and drink and laid him down again. The angel of the Lord came again the second time and touched him and said, arise and eat, because the journey is too great for thee. And he arose and did eat and drink and went in the strength of that meat 40 days and 40 nights into Horeb, the mountain of God. Now, I think, to me at least, the most significant thing about all of this is verse 9, the very next verse. Now, God is still moving. There's still miracles taking place here, right? So Elijah takes this 40-day journey, and he came thither into a cave. I'm saying right now, the cave is a metaphor for the flesh. It's isolation, it's separation, it's a dark place, it's a place of fear. It's a place where you go to try to find some kind of protection for yourself, amen? And so he goes to the cave and he lodges there. He starts living in this cave. And behold, the word, now God had been feeding him in the desert. He fed him by the brook Cherith. He gave him water, and when the water ran out, he gives him another. And no, now he's in the flesh. He's walking in the flesh. He's in a cave, amen? And the word of the Lord came to him, and he said unto him, what are you doing here?
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. Amen. Elijah's problem wasn't that different from Israel's. He just allowed the image of God to be shaped by circumstances. He just began to shrink God to the size of what he believed was happening in his life, in his situation. Now, in the book of Isaiah, the prophet Isaiah has a situation that is, it's kind of like the way things are for most people. In Isaiah, if you will, Roberto, go to Isaiah chapter 6 and read verses 1 through 4. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne. We sing this song fairly often here. And he saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. You got to realize this is a time when everything was really pretty screwed up for Israel. And all of a sudden, Isaiah gets a revelation. He has a vision of God being far greater than what they had thought. He sees him high and lifted up, seated on a throne, and his train filled the temple, amen? And above it, above the throne, stood the seraphims, angels. Each one had six wings, and with twain he covered his face, with twain he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly. Praise the Lord. 3 and 4. And one cried unto another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. It's what we were talking about earlier. Just because we're not looking and seeing doesn't mean that God isn't everywhere. His glory is everywhere. It just takes somebody to have a revelation of that, somebody to open their eyes to the fact that he is there, he is moving, he has an agenda, he has a plan and a purpose, and it will be accomplished if somebody will believe it. His word will not come back to him void if someone will receive it and declare it. Amen. And so the posts of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. Praise the Lord. Drop down to verse 8. Also, I heard the voice of the Lord. Now, there's noise going on here, and the posts of the temple are moving, and there's all this sound going on, right? And then the voice of the Lord saying, Whom shall I send, and who will go for us? And then said I, Here am I. Send me. Somebody, all of a sudden, their attention was grabbed, and they're like in shock, and then a voice comes. And immediately he recognizes God's voice. He may not have heard God's voice in I don't know how long, but for some reason he hears it this time. And his immediate response is, I'll go. He's not afraid. He's not thinking about what the challenges might be, or the potential for failure or danger or anything. Send me. God has gotten really big. He's filled the temple. He is everything now, and he has total confidence that God can do whatever he wants to do. I want to be in on this. Send me. Let me go. I bet if you'd asked him 24 hours earlier, he'd have said, Here am I. Send her. Praise the Lord. Right? We believe for you, but not so much for me. Praise God. But Isaiah lived in a culture that's a lot like ours. God shrinking culture. On the way to church this morning, this isn't an indictment on anybody that's not here. I'm not nitpicking anything else. The ball diamonds are full today. The golf course is full today. I drive by both on my way here. And that thing is wanting to get in. You know what I'm saying? And Sally said, you know it's summertime. The church parking lots are almost empty. We live in a God-shrinking world. I'm not condemning these people. Come on. I'm not. I'm just saying we live in a world where God isn't that big a deal. I'm talking about in the world. I'm not talking about us as believers, but I'm talking about as the way the world is. And that can influence us. It can have an impact on us. It had an impact on Israel. It had an impact on Isaiah. It had an impact. It has an impact on people when we live in a culture that diminishes God. Isaiah has this fresh encounter with God. God, all of a sudden, became big again, became awesome again. And his immediate response is, I want to be involved in this. Send me. I want to see what else you're going to do. Amen? All right, Romans chapter 12, verses 2 and 3. Again, we're still talking about us. Amen? Romans chapter 12, verses 2 and 3. Be not conformed to this world. And I'm not talking about the way you dress, necessarily the music you listen to or the movies that you like to watch, or the activities that you're involved in. He's talking about conform to the way the world thinks, the way it goes about its daily routines. We heard people here this morning talking about what God is doing in their life. You know, God does this for people all the time because we live in a dispensation of grace. But only the people that are looking for God recognize that God's doing it. They just think I had a good day. It was lucky today I got that parking spot. What a break for me. That lady told me about the package deal. Man, I was just in the right place at the right. No, God directs the steps of the righteous. Amen. And he's doing good to everybody in this generation, in this dispensation that we live in. But only those that are aware of it ever acknowledge it. So his glory does fill the earth, but only the people that are aware of his presence give him the glory for it. Give him the glory back. Make that glory a reality. Amen. So don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed. How? By the renewing of your mind, by the way you think about stuff.
Yes. Yes.
And you do it so that you can prove what God is doing. That he is good, that he is acceptable and perfect will of God is to be a blesser.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. To be good. For I say, through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think. That's what happened to Elijah. He got to thinking about it was the stuff he was doing. I'm not saying he was an evil guy. I'm just saying he got to where he thought it was more about his righteousness, his abilities, his commitments. Because we find out that those commitments can go away in a hurry when resistance comes, when problems come, when circumstances change. Amen. So don't think too highly than we ought to think, but think soberly according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. Faith that makes the difference. Faith that'll keep you going when Jezebel says you're dead meat. You'll be roadkill by tomorrow.
Yeah.
It's faith that'll keep you believing. It's faith that'll keep you standing. Amen? Yeah. Elijah's fear and doubt spiraled to a place of suicide. He was in a suicidal depression. Praise the Lord. Just kill me, God. Apparently you're not going to do anything for me, so kill me. Okay, 1 Kings 19, verse 9. He came thither unto a cave and lodged there. Remember I said now the cave's the flesh. He's out of the spirit, now he's in the flesh. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him and he said, what are you doing here, Elijah? Come on. You're supposed to be a man of faith. What are you doing in the flesh? It's the first question that God asked Elijah, and it's kind of like the same thing that he asked Adam and Eve. Because it's the first time they'd ever been in the flesh. They were spirits. Didn't need clothing, didn't need anything. They were just spirits. And the first moment they get in the flesh, what does God say? Where are you? Praise the Lord. To Elijah, it's, what are you doing here? All right, verse 10. And he kind of gives a similar response that Adam gave. It's your fault. Me and the woman you gave me. You know, share the blame here. And he said, I've been very jealous for the Lord.
Yeah.
He's made, you know, his excuses. Come on, I've done everything you asked me to do. What am I doing here? You bailed on me. For the children of Israel have forsaken your covenants. Nobody's doing this stuff but me.
Right?
Right? They've forsaken the covenants. They've thrown down your altars. They've slain the prophets with the sword. And I, only me, Lord, in case you hadn't noticed, am left. And they're out to kill me to take my life.
Yeah.
Why in the world would I be anyplace but here?
Right.
How do you expect me to be in the spirit when you and everybody else is against me? It's one thing when they're against me, but now when you team up with them. What am I doing? See, wrong thinking that Elijah had developed created a victim mentality. Woe is me. It's not my fault. Everybody else is screwed up. And I got to deal with it. Up until Jezebel threatened him, he looks like a superhuman. He looks unstoppable. Looks like, what in the world could ever stop this guy? And then fear invades his thinking. He was afraid, and he ran for his life.
Yeah.
Matthew chapter 14, verses 24 through 30. Fear makes cowards of us all. Amen. You can be a hero 1 minute and a coward the next. I'm sorry, 14, chapter 14, verses 24 through 30. Matthew 14, 24 through 30. And this is scripture we're all familiar with. The ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them, walking on the sea. How about, how many of you know he was in the Spirit? Jesus, he was walking in the Spirit. He was walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, it's a spirit. Even they recognized, there's a spirit walking. Amen? He's walking in the Spirit, right? And they cried out for fear. But straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, be of good cheer, it's I. Be not afraid. This is the constant theme of the Bible. Don't be afraid. Fear not. Don't be afraid. Because if you get into fear, I can't work with you anymore. You won't trust me anymore. I can't do what I want to do for you because you're afraid. So it isn't a rebuke. It's a kind of a please, don't put yourself in a place that I can't help. So don't be afraid. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if thou bid me come unto thee on the water. And he said, come. And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried, saying, Lord, save me. Now, fear is never rational because the same wind was blowing when he got out of the boat walking. But he was focused on Jesus. He was trusting Jesus. He was in the Spirit. And now he's afraid. Well, I mean, that's irrational. I mean, for normal kind of thinking, it doesn't make sense. If you could do it 5 feet from the boat, you could do it 10 feet from the boat. Same wind, same waves, everything's the same. But immediately he's in the flesh. And the minute he's in the flesh, he sinks like a rock. Because he's not in faith anymore. He's not believing. He's not trusting. For whatever reason, he doesn't believe that Jesus will continue to keep him above the water. So it's like Peter. The noise of fear-filled thinking became so loud in Elijah's head that he couldn't hear anything else. You ever been there? Have you ever been in a situation where the anxiety, the potential for danger and harm or bad is so like a din in your head, a D-I-N in your head, that you can't hear anything else? People even try to speak to you things of the Lord, and it's just like they're speaking another language because all you can hear, and most of the time it's because you get alone. And when you're alone, bang, 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 bang. Well, Lord, about this happens. This is probably going to happen next. And this could happen. I think it's cancer. It's got to be cancer. Somebody else has got cancer. Everybody's got cancer. We're all dying. It's a horrible life. You know, what's bad? You know, you'll never get out of this mess. That debt will always just accumulate. It's just going to get worse. The kids are all going to be lunatics. They're all going to be drug addicts. None of them will get their life together. They're all messed up. Everything's messed up. The whole world's messed up.
Yeah.
And it's all you can hear. Whatever message is repeated the most and the loudest is going to determine your reflexive response to life,
yes,
to circumstances,
yes,
and to situations.
Yes.
That's why he says we need to be hearers of the word, constantly hearing God's side of this thing, God's promises, God's truth. Why? Because there's lots of voices. And they're not in agreement with the Word of God. And the one that we're hearing the most, the one that's the most repeated, the one that's the loudest is the one that we end up, that gets our attention.
That's exactly right.
And it causes us then to respond to our circumstances and our situations based on fear, based on doubt rather than faith. Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. Well, I don't know, but I've never heard an audible voice. Well, some people have, But that isn't what's important, because the scripture tells us here that God, who at sundry times and in divers manners spake in times past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days, that still be the days we're in, spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. That he's the Word made flesh. He's still speaking to us through the Word. You may get an audible voice. That's totally possible. But if you never get an audible voice, he's still speaking.
Yes.
He's still talking.
Yes.
We have to choose to listen.
Amen.
So it's not whether God speaks, but it's rather, do we hear him when he speaks?
Right.
You can't hear God's voice clearly, and therefore you cannot experience his presence personally until you get out of the flesh. Praise the Lord. And the flesh isn't the stuff you do. Flesh is the way you think. It's what you believe. Because the carnal mind is enmity with God. In other words, it's at odds with God because it doesn't think the way God thinks. God called Elijah to come out of the cave. Amen? 1 Kings 19, verse 11. And he said, go forth and stand upon the mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind rent the mountains and brake in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord wasn't in the earthquake. See, the cave is the flesh. It's walking in the flesh. And it's the place where fear-filled thoughts dominate. And God's first thing is to give him a word, and the word is, get out of there. Come closer to me. Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden. I'll give you some rest. I'll help you out here. So look at James chapter 4, verse 8. And this is exactly what he's saying in James 4 and 8. Draw near to God, and God draws near to you. Now, it's not like, you know, God's way off, but as you start moving towards God, he starts moving towards you. No, he's there all the time, but you're just not aware of it until you start focusing on him. Then you start focusing, all of a sudden you realize, hey, he's been here all along. He never went anywhere. Right? Draw nigh to God, and he'll draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Double-minded man can receive nothing from God because he doesn't believe. He's hearing multiple voices. God called Elijah to a fresh encounter with the presence that could and would transform him. Elijah responded with silence. He didn't say, send me. He didn't say, I'll go. Amen. Because there were other voices in his head competing with God's voice. So God decided to use some noises, just like he did with Isaiah. The place shook. The voices cried out. And he's going, what? And then he hears the voice of the Lord. 1 Kings chapter 19, again, verses 11 and 12. Sometimes the big noise in your life is not the problem. Sometimes the big noise is just to get your attention from all the little competing noises. So he said, go forth and stand upon the mount before the Lord. Behold, the Lord God passed by, and a great and strong wind rent the mountains and break in pieces the rocks before the Lord. How many of you know you don't want to be in a cave in an earthquake? That's the last place you want to be, is in a cave. If he wasn't motivated to get out of the cave before, the earthquake was a great motivator. This is not a safe place to be. Rocks are falling everywhere. The whole thing could cave in on me, right? So wind and broke in pieces the rocks before the Lord, but the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake, but the Lord wasn't in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. This wasn't a little you know, like tongues of fire on the day of Pentecost. This is like a raging fire. But the Lord wasn't in the fire. But that sure got Elijah's attention.
Yeah.
And the next thing that happens, a still small voice.
Yes.
Yes.
Amen.
Awesome. Yes.
Life will get your attention.
Sure.
But God wants to speak to you. And he says, you know, things happen, but all things can and will work together for good to them that love God, that trust God, that believe God.
Yes.
Bad stuff, earthquakes, winds, fires, destructive stuff in your life. It isn't God that sends them, but God can sure use them to get you to focus.
Yes.
So that you'll hear his voice.
Yes.
God got Elijah's attention. The wind, the earthquake, the fire. Think about it. Jonah refused to go to Nineveh. And then all of a sudden, a storm and a man swallowing fish. That'll get your attention. So that he could hear what God was really wanting to do. In Noah's day, people wouldn't listen. They wouldn't listen to Noah. And what happened? A flood. When Peter walked on the water, God didn't send the storm. The storm was a natural result of fallen creation. Jesus walked right over the storm. God used that storm, that flood, to deliver Noah and his family so that the earth could be purged and cleansed of all this unrighteousness and mixed humanity and demonic. If you understand what was going on there, humans had intermingled with giants, with demons, and the whole earth was tainted. That's why the scripture says Noah was the only righteous man. It doesn't mean that Noah was the only, that he was perfect or good. He was the only one that had still pure bloodlines through which the Messiah would eventually come. The Pharaoh refused to listen. God didn't want to kill him. God didn't want to destroy them. He wanted him to listen. If you know, if you think about it, the Egyptians who put blood on the doorposts and the lintels, because they went out a mixed multitude, there were Egyptians that went out with the Israelites. They were spared. He wasn't out just to kill Egyptians. He was out to deliver Israel and anybody that was willing to believe and to go along with it. So it wasn't his agenda to torment and kill the Pharaoh. His agenda was to get his attention.
Exactly.
Get him to listen to what God was saying. He refused to listen. The plagues.
Yep.
Humanity refused to believe. And God sends Jesus.
Yes.
The greatest revelation of grace. Emmanuel. God with us. God's presence. It wasn't in the wind. His presence wasn't in the earthquake. His presence wasn't in the fire. 1 Kings again, 19, verses 11 and 12. He said, go forth, stand upon the mount before the Lord. Behold, the Lord passed by, and a great strong wind rent the mountains, breaking pieces the rocks before the Lord. And the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake, a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a still small voice. Elijah lost touch with the sound of God, with intimacy with God, because of the noise in his head. The voices were loud. They just weren't God's. So back to Matthew 14, excuse me, verse 28 through 31. Peter answered and said, Lord, if it be thou, bid me come unto thee on the water. And he said, come. And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus, but when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid. Beginning to sink, he cried, saying, Lord, save me. Verse 31. And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him, said unto him, O thou of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt? Peter was walking in the Spirit till voices in his head dominated. And then he began to walk in the flesh. The same voices that caused him to sink caused him to cry out to God. Again, he said, I'll work all things together for good. Even when you get in the flesh, I'll use that noise. I'll use the same things that put you into fear to cause you to reach out to me.
Yes.
God didn't want it to be that way. He wants it to be that it's the goodness of God that draws us
right.
to repentance or change the way that we think about him. Praise God. For 3 years, Elijah stood up to everything there was. An enemy trying to take his life. Single-handedly, he challenged the false religion of the day. And then the fear and the anxiety crept into his thinking and totally took over. God used the sound of the wind, the earthquake, and the fire to get Elijah's attention before he spoke. Genesis chapter 3. Verses 8 through 10. They heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord amongst the trees of the garden. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, Where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself. Now, the scripture says that they heard the voice of the Lord walking in the garden. So I'm trying to figure out, were they hearing the voice of the Lord or were they hearing the walking? It was the walking. How many of you know God's probably got pretty big feet? Pretty heavy. They heard the noise of God in the garden. And it caused them to listen for a voice. He got their attention by walking through the garden, and then he spoke.
Yeah.
Where are you? It wasn't a threat. It wasn't intimidation. It was, where are you? Who told you you're naked?
Right.
Why are you in the flesh? Amen. First Kings 19, verses 12 and 13. Praise the Lord. Have I depressed you yet? Praise the Lord. I've been preaching to me all morning. So. After the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. After the fire, a still small voice. And it was so when Elijah heard it that he wrapped his face in his mantle and went out and stood in the entering in of the cave. And behold, there came a voice unto him and said, What are you doing here, Elijah? He came into the presence of God, and God just said, What are you doing here? The voice of the Spirit always leads us to the presence of the Spirit. If you don't hear, if you're hearing all this other, chances are you're not going to get into the presence of God. So you're not going to see manifestation.
Right.
You need to be able to hear God in order to get to the presence of God.
Right.
That's why he'll use whatever he has to use to get your attention so that he can speak to you and get you to come into his presence. Because in his presence is fullness of joy.
Yes.
At the right hand of God is pleasures forevermore. All of the answers that we have need of are in the presence of God.
Yes,
you've got to be in the Spirit to get there. You can't operate in the flesh. You can't walk around numb and deaf to the sound of God's word, to the promises of God, and expect any manifestation. Because the enemy's job is to go around like a roaring lion. Oh, this is bad news coming down the path now. I'm going to eat you. I'm coming to get you. Your life is a mess. You're never going to work out. It's all going to be horrible. It's all fear, intimidation, anxiety. So Elijah covers his head, moves towards the presence of him who spoke. Verse 14. And he said, I have been very jealous for the Lord of God of hosts. He's still playing the me game instead of the you. Because the children of Israel have forsaken your covenants, thrown down the altar, slain thy prophets with the sword, and I'm the only one left. And they seek my life to do it away. That's his response. I'm fed up, Lord. I'm tired of this. Stuff ain't happening the way it was supposed to happen. You didn't show up when I thought you were going to show up. Everybody's out to get me. Nobody's on my side. Everybody's against me. Even I think you are against me. Either you're against me or you just don't care anymore. I can't do this anymore. I can't go on like this. As if he ever was doing it in the first place. But see, he's in the flesh. So it's all about him. It's what I've been able to accomplish. And now I can't. And it's your fault. It's everybody else's fault. All right, let's go on and we'll read verses 15 through 18. And the Lord said unto him, go, return on thy way to the wilderness of Damascus, and when thou comest, anoint Hazael to be king over Syria. And Jehu, the son of Nimshi, shalt thou anoint to be king over Israel. And Elisha, the son of Japhet of Abimeloah, shalt thou anoint to be a prophet in your room. I'm going to give you somebody to come alongside you. In other words, he's saying, I'm influencing people for you. Right. I'm going to set this thing up. And if you know the story here, what he's telling him at the first part of this is, I'm setting up a political coup. I'm going to overthrow this entire mess.
Come on.
I'm just asking you to go and be part of it.
Right.
Share in it. But I'm doing it. I've already got this going on. I just need you to go and see what happens. And it shall come to pass that him that escapeth the sword of Hazael shall Jehu slay.
Right.
I'm going to take care of this mess. Okay? And him that escapeth from the sword of Jehu shall Elisha slay. That's his sidekick. Yeah, amen. That's the guy that's actually going to take over when he moves on to be with the Lord. Yet I have left me 7,000 in Israel, all the knees which have not bowed unto Baal. You're not alone. There's 7,000 of them out there. You may not have noticed, but they're there. And they're on your side because they're on my side. Amen. They haven't bowed their knee to Baal. And every mouth which thou hath not kissed him. Praise the Lord. God addresses each one of Elijah's distorted images. Elijah says, I did my part, nothing's working. God says, go back the way you came, and I'll go with you. Go back to where you were when you were in the Spirit, and you'll find that I'm there with you. Amen? Praise the Lord. You can do this. Why can you do this? Because I'm going to be there. I'm going to be there in the Spirit, not here in a cave. So go back to where you came from. Elijah, I reached out to these people, and they're against me. God, there are 7,000 who haven't bowed their knee. They're not all against you. There's people that have the same motives, the same desires, the same purposes, and they're my people.
Yes.
And they're with you.
Yes.
Elijah, I'm all alone. Nobody's with me. God, I have influenced people to help you and make you victorious, cause you to be successful. Elijah, my future's gone. Everything's against me. Have you noticed how hard it is to get back in the Spirit once you've come to the flesh? I mean, once you got to the place where you're having the pity and the, you know, nothing's going to work out, and blah, and no matter what promises you believed in the past, you go back and you look at them, well, yeah, that was great back then, but my future's over. Nothing's going to happen now. Everything's against me. And God says, you will succeed. You will be victorious over the enemy because I am with you.
Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Elijah was in the cave because the flesh distorted his images. And he kept seeing these distorted images over and over and over. It wasn't until he had a fresh encounter with God's presence that he was able to hear God's voice and believe in the word. And that is a revelation of grace.
Yes.
Yes.
Not what Elijah could do, but what God wanted to do. Gave him a new picture of his life. Gave him a new picture of his destiny. You have a purpose. You have a calling. You may not understand it. You might not be able to explain it. But you can discover it. But for that, you have to risk again. You have to step out. You have to exercise faith. You have to believe God. Believe you are the righteousness of God. Believe his word. And experience his presence. And you will manifest his power. In Jesus' name. Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise God. We're all Elijahs. On fire one day. In control, in charge, believing for everything and anything. And just a few circumstances later, hiding in caves. Listening to all the trash that is not God. God will use that same chaos to get you to turn back to him so that you can hear his voice and discover your true destiny. Who you really are in Christ and what he really wants for you to experience in this life so that his glory will continue to fill the earth and that more and more people will be aware of that glory. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless all of you. Appreciate you being here. Thank you for your patience this morning. Have a great week. Believe God. Good things are happening, amen. You're blessed in the name of